Being a kid is fun because you can go to all these different places and you don't have to work that much and you could just go around and play.
Being a kid is having fun all of the time.
Adults can drive a car. Kids cannot.
Kids can go around and play while the grown-ups have to do the work and clean the houses, do the dishes.
My dad is fun. He is really caring. He is helpful. He makes the right decisions.
Love?
He's a provider. He provides, he blesses us. He provides the things that we need to survive. I think being adopted is like when you didn't have a family or your family can't take care of you, they give you up to the center and another family will take care of you. I think that's what adoption means.
Well, good morning. I want to extend my welcome as well as to those joining us online or by venue. And I know what everyone's thinking is, can this guy get off stage so we can just keep watching more videos of those adorable kids? My name is Soon Pak, and I'm glad to continue our series, I Am, and today we're focusing on I Am a Child. Theologian J.I. Packer wrote this about that concept. If you want to judge how well a person understands Christianity, find out how much he makes of the thought of being God's child and having God as his father. If this is not the thought that prompts and controls his worship and prayers and his whole outlook on life, it means that he does not understand Christianity very well at all. Other theologians talking about that concept of being a child of God and God being our father says it is the heart of the gospel, the heart of the Christian message, the heart of the good news of what he has for us, this grace. That we are no longer slaves or orphans, but a child of God. Now, so often when we're called a child, it's rarely in a positive context. It's usually you're acting like a child, or you're just a child, or you're such a child. I try to take it as a compliment that I'm just youthful, but most of the time it's not in the positive way. It really talks about it's an assessment of your behavior or attitudes, that it's not really in acting accordance to your age. For example, if someone says you're just a child, it primarily means that you're, because of your age, you're not really comprehending the situation that's at hand. Or if someone says you're such a child, usually means that you're acting in a way that is actually immature, or in a way that's less than what others expect you to be. And in both cases, we're really referring to, like I said before, a behavior or attitude. But today, when we talk and say, I am a child, we're really talking about identity. It's really talking about who you are as a person that shapes and makes the person that you are. And not any child, but a child of God. Every night, we read books to our children, and our two boys in particular. We read books. One of my favorite books I get to read to them is this book called The Boy Who Lost His Name. The Boy Who Lost His Name. And you can customize those books. You can send in your child's name or your grandkid's name, and they'll make the book according to that child's name. And the story goes, but the child wakes up and he forgets his name. He forgets his or her name. They forget their name and they go on this adventure where they go and do some amazing things and meet some really interesting characters. And each adventure, at the end of it, they give the child a letter. And they go through until he's collected all the letters of his names, and he finally goes back to his room and he remembers his name because he has the letters and he can finally fall asleep. It's one of my favorite books because my kids' names are short, Levi and Titus, thus making the book short. I mean, I obviously love reading to my kids, but you know, every night it can get long. Our daughter Her name is Abigail, so I'll have to find a different book to read to her. But I think also I like it because there's a deeper meaning. That all of us, we live in a life of adventure. We go and we go from thing to thing. And sometimes they're exhilarating, and sometimes they're exciting, and sometimes they're very painful, and sometimes very hurtful. And I think in all of life, we go searching and searching and searching for a name. And it's only when we find God our Father, and he gives us that name and identity, that we can finally have peace, that we finally can rest, and we can finally live into the life that God has for each and every one of us. So today we're going to talk about what does it mean to live into that, live into being a child of God. And there's three steps. One, it is breaking that slave mentality. Second is embracing the child identity. And third is trusting in a God who never forgets, trusting in a God who never forgets. In our text today that was read, Galatians 4, 1 through 7, there's some words in there that could be roadblocks for us to really receive what God has for us, what Paul meant for us. Two really loaded, controversial topics. One is the question that Paul, it seems like, is only addressing sons. He seems like he's only addressing sons. If you're a son, you've been received in adoption. Does that mean if I'm a woman, is there a place for me? And second, there's this question of, he talks about this use of the word slavery and being a slave. How does that really fit our modern definition? Two very heavy topics. I'm going to try to answer them in 2 minutes or less so it doesn't become a roadblock for us where God has. One is this, is there a place for me if I'm a woman? Absolutely. Paul goes out of his way to show that in Christ we are all children through God in faith. Just a chapter earlier he says this, so in Christ Jesus you are all children of God through faith. For all of you who are baptized into Christ have clothed yourself with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male or female, for you are all alone in Christ Jesus. In this ancient world, where all that mattered is where you came from, what your social status was, and what your gender was, that shaped who you were and what your life was going to be. It didn't just shape just you, it shaped your children's future. It shaped the trajectory of your life. All that, Paul gives this foundational change and says, none of that matters. All that matters is that you are part of God's family. Paul then uses an analogy from this kind of patriarchal ancient world where all things would be passed from the father to the son, to one particular son, and with no mention or thought of daughters in that family. He now says that both men from all different backgrounds, whether you're from outside the family or not, and women in part of that community, he says, all of you are like that son who receives an inheritance. He elevates men from all backgrounds as well as women to be just like that heir who receives an inheritance. This would have been unheard of the time. Paul is not just addressing men in Galatians 4, but he's using a common analogy of power, this power to show that the blessing is both for men and women. So the promise is for all of us. Second, this idea of slavery. Is there a distinction between biblical slavery and what we think of today? And absolutely, yes. Paul uses this Greek word called doulos. And then throughout the New Testament, that word is translated slave or servant. Even in Romans 1, when Paul addresses himself, it says, Paul, a doulos of Christ Jesus. And that your translation probably has it, Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus. But it could easily have been translated to a slave of Christ Jesus. In that biblical ancient world, slavery was common in both their worlds. In the Old Testament, there's even provision of the slave slash servant in that context. Laws to protect, provide, and guide. Very different from what we think of today. Even in Exodus 21:6, it talks about this and saying, whoever steals a man and sells him, anyone found in possession of him shall be put to death. The idea of owning someone where we would buy and we'd steal someone and sell them without agreed mutual agreement was an atrocity to the point that the punishment was death, not just for the person who did it, for the person who owned someone. Now, for our context, slavery in our history, and even in our modern context today, is evil and should be exterminated. To the millions who are subjugated to it, to the 30 million or so that are under the oppression of slavery today, in modern-day slavery, the church should unite to bring justice to this great injustice of our time. But it shouldn't be a roadblock to our text today, where the word slave and slavery is really talking about ownership of possessions and what they have power and authority to do, that this heir is no different than a slave or a servant. By why he technically owns all things, he does not have access to it. 2 minutes, hopefully 2 minutes or less. Now let's talk about what it means to live into being a child of God, breaking that slave mentality. Paul uses that analogy of an heir who's underage and is under the guidance of these guardians. And I spoke earlier that this was a common plan of action. Family life in ancient Rome was very different from family life today. When we think of families, young families, old families, there's this love and mutual affection that binds us together. In the Roman world, family life was all about power and influence. And who had that power was the patriarch of the family. The head of the family, the oldest living male was the patriarch. He had absolute power. He had power to disown, to sell, and even kill his own children without any retribution or correction. Even after a child was born, a baby was born in his family, the midwife would take that baby and place it at the foot of the patriarch. If the patriarch lifted, went down and swooped and picked him up and held him, then that baby would be engrafted into the family, enjoying the blessing. But if the patriarch did not pick that baby up, the midwife would take that baby and take it out to the road to be discarded, to be abandoned, to be killed, that they were rejected away from the family. It was a family life structured on power and influence. Even if they were picked up, growing up in that family, the child would not enjoy all the benefits of the household, but rather until a point in time, the patriarch was set for him or her, they would receive the blessings and the possessions. But during that time, they would be under this tutorship or guidance of an instructor. Now, Paul uses that analogy, but he gets a little more explicit in just a chapter before. He says this, "Before the coming of this faith, we were held in custody under the law, locked up until faith that was to come would be revealed." The faith that was to come would be revealed. "So the law was our guardian until Christ came that we might be justified by faith." Paul goes on to say that now this faith has come, we are no longer that guardian, no longer a slave, no longer bound to the law, no longer restricted by the law. Now the law was given to point us in the right direction, but it never really satisfied our deepest desires and eventually became this list of rules. Lists of things that made us live a certain way, to tidy up, to clean up, to measure up. And that only then and then only would you be accepted, would be accepted before God. And the word the Bible uses is righteous before God. But as Paul says, now through Christ, we have been justified by faith, no longer bound by these laws. Here's this way we used to live where we just kept struggling and trying to get everything right. And he says we just could never measure up. But Paul gives us good news. It's not about that. Through Christ, you have been received, and now you have freedom to be accepted before God. But here's the reality. Why does it feel like we're still bound up? Why does it feel like we're still under this law? Slaves to our own addictions, our fears, our failures, those memories long forgotten by everyone except us. Bound up in our need to please, need to be right, need to be loved, need to be praised. And we become captive in our own prison, chained to our hurts and past. And sometimes it feels like the harder we try to escape, the stronger the chains become. It's because the deeper truth here is that we just can't fix ourselves. We just can't pull ourselves up by the bootstraps. We can't free ourselves. And breaking that slave mentality doesn't require more willpower. It requires something way beyond ourselves. When I was 8 or 9 years old, my dad grabbed me and said, "We're going fishing." I was like, "Okay." So here's me and my dad. We get on a boat with a couple of his friends. They put the life jacket on, and we start going out of the bay and headed toward open water. As an 8 or 9 year old going fishing with my dad, I was super excited. And as the boat started going, I'm pretty happy. And that excitement and joy started ebbing away as the waves got choppier and choppier and choppier. And I said boat earlier, but it was basically something you could just construct with some lumber from Home Depot, it felt like. But as we hit the ocean, open water, we got caught in the wake of a much larger vessel. And before I knew it, the waves came and the weight came. And the next thing I know, the boat flipped upside down. 8 or 9 years old, had no idea what was going on. Guess where I was? I was caught underneath the boat. So the boat had flipped side down. Here's me with my life jacket just bobbing in the water, not having any idea what just happened. And as the panic kind of started creeping in and the realization what I was, what was happening, next thing I know, something grabs me and pulls me underwater. Just a few seconds later, I come back up. And what happened is as soon as the boat flipped, my dad realized I was not there. He swam underneath, grabbed me, and just pulled me out from right under the boat. No matter how hopeless your situation may be, no matter how far lost you may feel, or how far beyond what you think you are, there's always a hero waiting to rescue you. There is no way, as my 8 or 9 years old self could have gotten out of that situation. But my dad rescued me. And in the same way, wherever you're trapped, wherever you feel like you just can't get out of it, no matter what book you read, no matter how hard you try, only a hero can come and rescue you. And that hero is the face and the person of Jesus Christ, no matter the depths of your pain. So how do we break that slave mentality? It's only through Jesus. And how do we embrace that child identity? Paul continues and writes, "But when the set time had fully come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law, that we might receive adoption to sonship." Paul uses the word adoption here, adoption. It's a really strange use, this Greek word, huiothesia. You see it a couple other times where Paul writes it, but all through Scripture, it never shows up. And in Hebrew culture and in Jewish history, the idea of adoption is just foreign. You see a couple cases of it, but it's not a common term you see in that culture. So for the Hebrew and Jewish people, for them to hear the word adoption, it would have been something that had a cultural relevance to their lives. But adoption was a very strong and prominent word in the ancient Roman world. Adoption was something they used a lot in that ancient Roman world. We've already talked about that Roman family life was not about love, but about power and influence. And what they did is as their family grew in power and influence, if they didn't have a male heir that could transfer that, what they would do, they would go and adopt another male son, another son. They would go to another family and they would pay money and they would adopt that son and graft him into their family so that when it came of age that they could transfer the power and influence of that family into Roman society. And that's how adoption worked in that Roman world. But Paul invokes this Roman word, adoption, into the life of these believers. And he says this, that here's God. Here's God with all the power, authority, influence, and majesty out there. He says, I'm going to give up my one and only son, my firstborn. I'm going to let him be sacrificed so that I can adopt you into my family. Paul says this, that God, who had everything, gave up his son, his one and only son, so for the outcast, for the abandoned, for the child left on the side of the road, those worthless, says, you are of worth to me. And I want to adopt you into my family, into God's forever family. What is your worth to God? Absolutely everything. He sent his one and only son so that you could be adopted into God's family forever. I recently read an article about a woman named Amy who escaped a life of addiction and confusion and who shared exactly what it meant to understand that worth in that moment. She says, I hardly know how best to describe it. I felt God literally give me his very heart. There was this heart wrapping around mine. It is a heart filled with loving tenderness, forgiveness, and I could feel his pain for me. He knew all of my painful relationships. Then he spoke into my heart, why have you put all these other affections into one person after another, thinking they can help heal and restore you? It was at that moment I knew no one could ever heal or restore me. I was this love, this forgiving heart, that deep conviction that I knew I had to surrender my emotions to him. to take God's heart and walk back into his arms. And that is what I did, and I've never been the same. That's for you, that you are a child of God. This cannot and will not be taken from you. John says this in chapter 8, now a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. So if the son has set you free, you are free indeed, that you are a child of God. Every time doubt, fear, your hurts, insecurities re-coax you to rewear the chains of bondage, know that you're a child of God, and through the forever grace and sacrifice of Jesus Christ, you are his forever and ever and ever. Embracing that child identity, knowing your worth, that you are adopted into God's family forever and ever. And then finally, we live in the tension. We know we break free from that slave mentality, and we want to embrace that child identity, but we struggle in the in-between. So finally, we have to lean into this idea of trusting in a God who never forgets. Galatians 4, 6 through 7, because you are his sons, God sent the spirit of his son into your heart, into our hearts, the spirit who calls out Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but God's child. And since you are his child, God has made you also an heir. The circumstances and situations of this world, the brokenness of our own sinfulness and the hurt in our relationships can bring us to forgetfulness. I know it's hard for us adults in this room, but to really embrace the childlike spirit, to come to the King as a child, remembering who God is and that he does not forget us, that we can go to him with boldness, that he does not forget us. I want to invite a special guest onto the stage, our children's director, Cindy Ziemba. She was leading a staff meeting this week, and she shared this real powerful story of a missionary named Beth in Mexico who oversees some orphanages. And one of the directors of the orphanage is Edgar, and he has dealings with some of the children, and just remembering that God doesn't forget us. And I want to have her share the story.
I'm hungry. The cries for more food were ringing in Edgar's ears. He heard those words from more than 50 different voices every day at the children's home where he was director. But it was November. It was starting to get cold, and he needed to pay for heat. Donations were down, and he was running out of money. Should we use our remaining money for heat, blankets, or food? Edgar wondered out loud. He was reminded of the story of Joseph in prison he had taught the children, how God had not forgotten Joseph, even though others did, and how Joseph eventually became God's instrument to save thousands of people from starving. Edgar could have picked up the phone and called the back-to-back ministry headquarters at night. There were emergency kits of beans, rice, eggs, oil, and tortillas. But something in his heart knew that the children were putting people on a pedestal fit only for the King, the giver of all good gifts. Saying a prayer, he called the children to gather around the tables where no plates were set out. Edgar started, "We don't have anything for dinner tonight." One of the youngest, a boy named Joel, looked around with big eyes, checking to see if anyone else thought it was a joke. Edgar continued, "But this is what we know. You are the children of the Most High King, and you are not forgotten. So let's pray and ask the King for our dinner. Dear Lord, we thank you for your many blessings on these children and on this home. We humbly ask that you would provide a meal for us tonight." Suddenly, he was interrupted by Joel. "Uncle Edgar, are you serious? Are we really praying for God to bring us dinner?" Joel looked at him incredulously. "What kind of food does God deliver?" "Joel," Edgar replied, "God loves you and you are his child. Yes, we are asking him for dinner. He's your father and he wants you to know he sees you. It's he who owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. Every part of creation belongs to him. So let's just see what he will deliver us." They bowed their heads and began to pray again, when Joel, unable to sit still, interrupted Edgar once more. "Do you think, will the Lord bring us meat?" To a boy whose diet was mainly beans and rice, tortillas and hot dogs, real meat seemed like a mighty ask. Edgar took a deep breath. 50 pairs of eyes were on him. Joel, you can ask for anything in the Lord's name. So they bowed their heads again, praying for dinner and meat in Jesus' name. But while the other heads were still bowed, Joel blurted out, "Uncle, what kind of meat does God bring you? What can I ask for? How can I pray?" Across town, the phone rang at back-to-back ministry headquarters. "Beth, it's Carlos. I'm in town for a convention. Hey, do you have a pickup truck you could bring by?" "Yes," Beth answered, "but why would we need that?" "Oh, I just thought you might want some of my leftover product. Do you? It's been here all day, and I can't fly it back over the border. People are already starting to throw it out. But I was thinking about your kids." "Carlos, I hate to admit this, but I misplaced your business card. What kind of product are we talking about?" "Oh, I represent a meat company. We're here at a big convention trying to attract new restaurants. I'm going to discard the samples, which have been thawing all day, and there are lots of others here like me. Could you use some meat if I round it up?" Beth's husband, Todd, called her from the convention center. "Beth, there's way too much meat for us to store in the deep freezer. I've got straps holding it down on the back of the pickup. I'm going to have to unload some at the children's homes nearby." Joel's home was the first on the route. When Beth called to tell of the coming food donation, Edgar seemed strangely not surprised. "Beth, do you know what kind of donation is coming?" he asked. "Well, it's some kind of meat," Beth answered. "I'm not sure the details." "You don't know anything about it?" Exasperated, Beth tried to get off the phone to call other homes. "Edgar, do you have room in your freezer for some meat?" "Well, yes, I do, but would you mind terribly finding out what kind of meat it is and then calling us back?" "What do you mean, what kind of meat? It's meat, Edgar. It's food. Why should it matter?" "Well, Beth, it does matter. Would you mind calling me back when you know?" Todd was already on his way when Beth called. "Todd, this is kind of an odd question, but do you know what kind of meat you have? I don't know when we've got so picky, but Edgar wants to know." "Oh, Beth, you won't believe it. It's the best cuts. Steak, beef, pork, there's filet mignon, sirloin, New York strip. The homes are gonna love it." Beth couldn't help but notice how relieved Edgar sounded when she called. "Praise God," he breathed into the phone. And then she heard him shout out to the children, "God is on his way over with your meat." Beth heard the explosion of voices, the children erupting into cheers. Edgar got back on the phone. "Oh, Beth, remember this day. We are not forgotten."
I don't know your story. I don't know what brought you into this place, but I hope you leave with this, that you are not forgotten. God has not forgotten you. God remembers your story, and God wants to, from on high, swoop down low, pick you up, and say, "You are mine, and you are a son or daughter of the Most High King." Let's pray. God, we are forever grateful for the amazing grace that you give us. Lord, only through your power and work, through the sending of your Son, Father, that we can lift our heads above the muck and mire of our lives and with boldness and faith say, "I am no longer a slave. I am no longer an orphan, but I am a child of God." We pray this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.